Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Well, the virus is getting worse in the community. So, I don't know what that means for us, even separated like this and with masks on. But the worship committee meets tomorrow night and session meets in 2 weeks. And so, sometime in there, we'll figure out the best course of action for our future to keep everybody safe and well. Even so, we continue to plan things for the fall. The retreat is scheduled for September the 19th. Is that right? And the deadline, 17th, that weekend. The deadline is September 1st. Thank you for my coaching here. So you can sign up for that, and if it doesn't happen or something changes, you know, we'll all be all right. There's also a book study, Women of the Bible Speak, for women, planned for September, October, and November on a Tuesday night. So once a month on a Tuesday, and that is, there's a sign up and more information out there in the narthex. Susan Knowles is going to teach it in person, and Susan Rockmore is going to teach it via Zoom. So you can participate in that one way or another. I think that's all my announcements, but it's good to see you all here this morning. Welcome. Let's prepare ourselves for worship.
Thank you.
If you're able, let's stand and join in the call to worship. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors.
Let no evil talk come out of our mouths, but only what is useful for building up.
Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal.
Let us be kind to one another, tender-hearted, and forgive one another.
Let us worship God. Let us pray together. Your mercy is fresh every morning, O God. Your ways are just and true. You cause the day to dawn with the promise of life everlasting. In Christ we learn of your will. Your Spirit surrounds us with wisdom and guidance. You do not forsake us when we seek your counsel. Be pleased as we praise you, and make haste to hear us, for we assemble to honor you, God of new life. Since we are members of one another, put away falsehood and speak truth.
Forgive us, O God, for we deceive one another.
Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger.
Forgive us, O God, since we are prone to hold grudges.
Do not steal, but work honestly. Make yourselves able to give to those in need.
Forgive us, O God, for we squander your mercies and take no delight in sharing our means.
Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, only talk that builds up your neighbor.
Forgive us, O God, for we slander one another without being conscious of the destruction we cause.
Know that Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
If we are sorry and truly repent of our sin, in Jesus Christ we are forgiven.
Amen. All right, good morning. So I am talking to all the kiddos at home and who are far away traveling right now. And so today we're going to talk about superheroes and how I love me some superheroes because they have different skills and powers and special tools that they use to make the world a better place, right? But did you know that y'all are superheroes too? And you are called on a very, very special mission. So our lesson today comes from Ephesians. Now, Ephesians is actually a letter that Paul wrote. Now, Paul is an interesting character because he started off as a villain named Saul. And he was not a very nice man. And he did not like people who loved Jesus. But God changed his heart and he became one of the biggest superheroes for Jesus the world had ever seen. And so he's writing to folks to tell them and warn them about a kryptonite. Now, everybody knows what kryptonite is, right? If you don't, kryptonite is this glowing green crystally rock thing that when Superman gets near it, it starts draining his power. And he can't do good stuff because he gets really, really weak. Well, the kryptonite that Paul was writing to warn people about was anger. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes when I get angry, I can't focus. I can't love people like I need to love because I'm just so angry. And it just gets in the way and stops me from doing good. However, Paul did write and tell people that we've got tools in our superhero tool belt that can help us against that kryptonite. The first one is love. Now, when we are angry, we can't help people get through things or care for them. But when we love, we can love and help somebody get through just about anything, right? The second tool, and is a big one, is forgiveness. Because when we forgive someone, when they've done us wrong, we are able to then love them in return. So as you go throughout this week, if you get angry, remember, suit up and pull out that love and that forgiveness out of your tool belt and take a deep breath and ask God to help you to get rid of that kryptonite so that it's not slowing you down from getting out there and doing that special mission that God has called us all to do. All right? So let us pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, help us to be superheroes for you. Help us to use love and forgiveness to help the world. Amen.
I have heard drywall referred to as kryptonite. So we read from Ephesians 4, 25 to chapter 5, verse 2. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of the Lord. So this one time we were going somewhere and went into the airport magazine shop. And Susan bought this fashion magazine about 4 inches thick and got on the plane and read it in 3 minutes because there's nothing in there but pictures. But every page, every picture has a sample perfume. You ever have one of those magazines? They smell really good, if you like that kind of smell. Now, did you ever try those expensive jelly beans that taste like other things? I mean, it's just wrong. Jelly beans should taste like sugar, but they make them that taste like all kinds of other things, like raw onions and worse. So which would you rather have, a magazine that smells good or jelly beans that taste like onions? We all know that smell and taste are related. So if something smells good, it probably tastes good. And smell is important. Paul knows this. He writes about all the things in life that might smell bad. Things that don't give off a pleasant scent, things that don't please God. Anger, lust, greed, impatience. Those are the things that we have to conquer in our lives. And Paul tells us what the church will look like when all is well. And so tells us what our lives will be like as we produce a fragrant offering to God. Now, we don't think much about fragrant offerings. But these people lived in a culture that made sacrifices and killed animals as offerings to God. They burned them, you know. They used a lot of spice and perfume and incense. I mean, Lazarus was in the tomb. Jesus said, open the tomb up. And they said, but he'll smell bad. It's been 4 days. And on the third morning after Jesus died, they went to the tomb with spices to prepare his body for permanent burial so that it wouldn't smell so bad if somebody else went in there. So the smell is part of the whole experience. And several times in Scripture, prayer is compared to incense, to a fragrant offering. So what pleases God is thought of in terms of how it smells. And Paul uses this image for our life together. May our life together be a pleasing fragrance to God. Now, when something's not right, when it just seems wrong, we say, oh, there's something fishy going on. That's a reference to how fish smell. Or we might even say, I smell a rat. We learn of something we don't like and we say, oh, that stinks. So the images of smell are there in our language. So what we need to do is make sure that nothing smells bad, you know? So what might make our life together smell bad? Well, falsehood is one. We're all parts of one body, and we're told to put away falsehood, speak the truth to each other. See, if one part of the body gives false information to another part, like a false signal to the brain telling it something that's not true, it damages the body's ability to function. So if you're running a computer, say, and it gets the wrong instructions from somewhere, it locks up and won't work properly. And then all you can do is unplug it and curse Bill Gates. false information leads to problems. It's interesting that we call renegade computer programs viruses. Our networks have the same need as our bodies for correct information. And so in the church, for everything to be working properly, we need truth. A community can't function without honest and accurate information. You know, if we lie to each other or we passively withhold information, we've hurt the church. And the Spirit of God is the Spirit of truth. So truthfulness in love is necessary for the healthy functioning of the body. Or there's anger. Anger is another bad smell. And Paul says, put away anger and bitterness and wrath. Well, there are different kinds of anger, you know. There's the kind that flares up when you're told something you don't like. There's the kind that you nurse and hold on to and keep alive for decades. It becomes rotten and bitter and poisons your whole body. And here, what Paul says is, be angry, yeah, but don't sin. He recognizes that we have tempers and we will get angry. We'll react to things and get angry. So the first thing for our life together is to recognize that, you know, anger happens. And we can look beyond it because it will cool off. So we'll get angry, but he says, don't sin. I think that means we ought not let our anger turn us against each other. We ought not nurture that anger and hold a grudge. Did you ever read The Count of Monte Cristo? It's a great novel. When I was in high school, I decided it was time to start reading great novels. And I think that's the first one I read. In that novel, a rich merchant unjustly imprisons this man. And he's in prison for years, but he finally escapes somehow, and I've forgotten how. But he spends decades then planning this rich guy's ruin. Talk about holding a grudge. Revenge becomes the purpose for this man's life. That's the kind of anger that grabs a hold of you and won't let go, and becomes a force that guides you and finally poisons your entire existence. And the world is full of people who have that kind of anger, who won't deal with or relate to other people because they can't let go of something that happened to your grandfather's grandfather long ago. You know, making enemies is just a part of the politics of doing business. In the church, though, things are different. Paul gives us this marvelous suggestion. It's almost a throwaway. He says, oh, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Don't go to bed mad. That way you won't nurse grudges for years. You won't hold things against people and plot their ruin and revenge. You won't get ulcers and cancers of body and soul. Don't go to bed mad. Well, to live that way means we have to get over our anger. And so we have to learn to identify its causes. And psychologists say that almost all of our anger is caused by unmet expectations. You expect somebody to do something. They don't do it, or it doesn't happen that way, and you get angry. So anger comes when we don't get our way. And every time I'm at the stoplight and it turns green and the guy in front of me is still talking on his phone and hadn't looked up, my expectations that he will drive are not met. Happily, all I do is scream at him inside my car. So, you know, family members say, "Dad, calm down." When things don't go our way, we get angry. Now, there are times when what we want is desirable and noble and good, and we get angry about an injustice or wrongdoing. There's that kind of anger, but the kind I'm talking about is when our own expectations and convenience is not met. So a way to handle anger is to examine our expectations. Why am I angry? You did not do what I wanted, as I wanted, when I wanted. Well, perhaps I could change what I want. I might decide my expectations are reasonable, and in that case, I need to explain to you clearly and calmly my expectations, and we can discuss them. That's far better than, as my senior pastor used to say, going home and putting the cat in the rinse cycle and kicking the dog. We had a dog. Well, don't go to bed mad also means reconciliation. You know, we have to go to those with whom we've had a disagreement and make peace. That's hard to do, isn't it? We've all had the experience of having a disagreement and walking away. And later, the anger cools and you just continue the relationship as though nothing happened. We pretend that the anger wasn't real. We pretend that the disagreement didn't happen. And so we pretend to be at peace. Reconciliation means coming back and fixing it, you know, winning the other person over again, restoring the relationship that's broken. So if we live that way, we bring peace among people. And that's how the church is called to live in peace. And to live in peace brings a fragrant spirit, pleases God. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. And don't make room for the devil. The word for devil there is slanderer. Give no opportunity to the slanderer. So to get over your anger without sinning is to prevent slander from happening. You won't get slandered and you won't slander others. Paul warns us that, you know, we can prevent all of this if we just do this. Because slander leads to another bad smell that he mentions, bad language and evil speech. Let only what is helpful and gracious come out of your mouth. And if we could all learn that lesson, to bring grace to every moment and to every encounter, that's the goal for a peaceful Christian. But why make the effort to do these things, you know? Well, these things hurt the body of Christ and grieve the Holy Spirit. I mean, imagine. God loves us with a love deeper than we can imagine or conceive. And the Spirit of God lives within us. And so by our actions, we hurt God. We make him grieve and suffer because of our slander and anger and falsehood. And to love God is to avoid the things that hurt God, just as we avoid hurting any other loved one. And God has marked us for redemption with the Holy Spirit, has redeemed us in Christ Jesus, who loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. That's the love that God has for us. That's the love that saves us. That's the love in which we live. So why would we take that love and profane it? Why would we take that love and hurt the body of Christ with, you know, bad-smelling actions? Paul calls us to put away all of that behavior and become like Christ Jesus. So we're called to be kind and generous and tender-hearted and forgiving. We're called to be people of grace. And what happens when the church lives this way? The main thing is that we please God. Our life becomes this fragrant offering, and so there's a fragrant spirit present. We share in the love of Christ and grow deeper in faith, and our faith matures, love deepens, and we're drawn closer to God. We become a community of people committed to living for Christ and living as He lived, contrary to the winds of culture. And when we live this way, we're able to accomplish the mission of Christ. So think how much energy and effort and goodwill is wasted in our conflicts. If we can't get along with each other and live in peace, then how can we do what Jesus calls us to do? And yet, the congregations in our country are filled with people who hold grudges against one another and fight for privilege and seek their own way at all costs, as if the church were simply a place to practice politics and exert power. Christ calls us to be different. A bad-smelling church can't participate in the mission of Jesus to the world. So we become witnesses for peace in a violent world. I mean, we're surrounded by anger and violence. If you don't believe it, just try confronting somebody in public who does something wrong. Or look at the road rage in our streets and our grocery store aisles. People in this culture are angry and will fight you over nothing. But to live for Jesus is to live for peace in this world, which is terribly difficult, but very satisfying. So we're to present God our fragrant offering, to live as Jesus lived, to honor Him, to be fed, as the Gospel of John says, to be fed with the bread of heaven rather than the bread of this world, and to give God all praise and glory day by day. That's our calling. And by the grace of God, it shall be so. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
brief statement of faith was written by Presbyterians in the 80s after the reunification of the North and the South. Civil War finally ended in 1983 for Presbyterians. And it's very long. It's way too long to say in worship. It takes like 8 or 10 minutes. And they recognized that. So they divided it into pieces. So you had this opening bit, and then a piece, and then the closing bit. And we're going to do them that way over 3 weeks. And so this is the part that talks about Jesus Christ. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, this Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. So as we gather for prayer, I can report to you that Mitzi Moody's knee surgery went very well. Charles says she's up and doing well. She said, pray for Charles, though he's a very good nurse. So we keep them in our prayers. John Holzhauser, who was suffering with kidney failure after his heart surgery, is much better, his daughter tells me. Was drinking protein shakes and is up out of bed and getting physical therapy. So we give thanks with him for that. Brenda Davis, who is Tracy Paul's mother, is better. She was in the hospital with pneumonia, and she's much better. Barry Wilson has been diagnosed with COVID. I don't know any more than that. Jim Tubner continues to have some struggles, and the doctors continue to try to figure out exactly what is his issue. And Richard Foley, we're told this morning, is in the hospital with some sort of infection. So, plenty to pray for and give thanks for. Let us pray. We give you thanks and praise, O God, for all of the blessings that come our way, especially for the blessing of the life and work, death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus. We give you thanks for the salvation and eternal life that he brings us. We give you thanks for your continued unfailing love and care for all of us. In life and in death, we do belong to you, O God. And so we give you thanks for these who are getting better. And we pray for these who still need continued medical care. And we pray for healing and wholeness for all of them. Even as we realize that sometimes healing does not come in the way that we expect or would prefer. We pray for those who grieve, that you would especially surround them with your comfort. We pray for our country, for those elected to lead us. We ask that you give them wisdom and courage, lead them to make decisions that will benefit our citizens. We pray for the people of other countries, for Turkey, where fires are burning the place down, for Afghanistan, where our troops leaving means something like civil war breaking out, and we pray for those people that they will be able to govern themselves and come to some peaceful resolution. We pray for those who suffer from fires in our own country, whose towns have been burnt down. We pray for your church. We pray that you will pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and let our life together be a fragrant offering in your presence and for the world to see and know. And we know that nothing in life or death can separate us from your love in Jesus Christ, and so we ask you to bless us in his name and hear our prayers in his name and hear us as we pray the very prayer that he taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
So go in peace. Go and present your life as a fragrant offering to God. And as you go, may all the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and every day forever. Alleluia.
Amen.